So Richard, if you want to go chanting, you can go. I mean, there's nothing that keeps you. Yeah. Then you come later. So you're okay? Why is she smiling? You're on fasting, so should have some energy. And Benny's nervous. So let's see if the person from Vietnam has some question. Yeah, go ahead and ask them.
So could you please tell me more about the false satipatthana?
What?
The false satipatthana. Satipatthana. As of satipatthana.
Oh, satipatthana. Mindfulness of breathing in and breathing out.
Not the whole satipatthana, kaya, bhutana, sutta, and
dhamma. What is it? Body? No. That's not necessary. Body? Feeling? Chitta? What is it? Kaya is a body, chitta is vedana is feeling,
dhamma.
And dhamma. What, dhamma? If I remember correctly, now you can correct me, to see the body within the body, to see the Dhamma within the Dhamma, to see the Chitta within the Chitta, or? It's about this? Huh? It's very high level. And the sutta starts with sati. Yeah? So, if you don't have that sati, then we have a problem. Yeah? Sati is the awareness, eh? The knowingness. The knowingness of the body, the knowingness of the chitta, the knowingness of the Dhamma, and the knowingness of feeling. And if you do not have this knowingness, it is very difficult to understand. But what it says, yeah, for the people who are just beginning is, I mean, these are four objects where we should put our attention on to. Yeah? And we do that, you know, when we do anapanasati, yeah? Anapanasati, I mean we observe the breath. Yeah? We observe the breath going in, going out. When our sati becomes deeper, we will not see only the breath, we will not know only the breath, yeah, at the tip of the nostrils, but we will know the whole breath body. Yeah? And then you come closer to the understanding of seeing the body within the body. But it is really difficult. It is just like in understanding that consciousness lapses. I mean, if your sati is not strong enough, you will not understand the meaning of it. And to explain it, I don't think I can do that. I mean, the Lord Buddha already gave the best description of it. And in order for you, I mean, there was one time when I understood what he was saying, yeah? Because I had enough sati, yeah? But that's it, you know? I mean, I don't know any better description for it. Then you actually see it, you know. I mean, you see it with your internal eyes. You see the body within the body. You see the feeling within the feeling. Yeah? But if your sati is not up to the speed, yeah, then you will not see it. Yeah. What you can do then is try to figure out, you know. But trying to figure out what he means is pretty much useless. Yeah. I mean, if you develop the sati, you develop the sati on anapanasati until you see the whole breath body. Yeah? Then you might come to the understanding of the body within the body. Yeah. Know the breath going in, know the breath going out, until you become more and more aware of the breath. Yeah? And the breath, yeah? I mean, it is the body. You will see all, you will see everything, yeah, within this breath body. You will feel that the breath goes in through your skin, yeah. You will feel that the breath goes out through your skin, yeah. You will see the connection between the heart and the breath. You will see everything, yeah. You will understand more and more about the body, yeah. So anapanasati is a very close relation, you know, to the body, yeah. But if our sati is not strong enough, I mean, then we just catch only, you know, the feeling at the tip of the nose. Yeah? And as long as we catch a feeling, yeah, the knowingness, the sati has not really developed. The sati is the knowing about the breath. Yeah? Once the breath becomes very subtle, most of the people say the breath disappears. It doesn't disappear. It's still there. Yeah? It is very subtle. Yeah? And then knowingness kicks in. Yeah? Knowingness has to appear. Knowingness, knowing that the breath is going in, knowing that the breath goes out. And then you will see a lot of things, or you will notice a lot of things, yeah, about the breath. Yeah? But if you are not really interested in the breath, we will not know. Yeah? And we are not interested. Yeah? Our mind constantly goes away. Huh? So first you have to get the mind down to one point, yeah? It is easier, yeah, to think about these things than to do them. And there's an interesting joke that relates to the problem somehow. An engineer, a physicist, and a mathematician were put into three different separate rooms. Yeah? Each one had a can of ravioli. Yeah? And they were locked up for 24 hours. Yeah? With no tools, just a table and a chair. They wanted to see how they are going to, how these different types of people, how they deal with the situation. So after 24 hours, they opened the room, and they looked. Yeah, first the engineer, his can was opened, and he was sitting there satisfied. So he somehow opened the can. And eaten the contents of the can. The next room, then they opened the next room, it was a physicist, yeah. He also managed to open the can and he also was satisfied, yeah. And then they opened the last room, the mathematician, yeah. He was sitting in front of his closed can and smiled, yeah. And then they asked him, why, yeah. I defined it open. So I defined it that I could eat it. And that is a lot of things. And why I say this, or why I bring it up, yeah? If we define ourselves not to have greed, then we don't have greed. Yeah? If we define ourselves not to have hate, then we don't have hate. And that happens very often in the West. Hmm? We don't want to tackle the difficult problems of opening this can, or we don't want to tackle the difficult problems, you know, of staying put, you know, on the point. Yeah. But we like to think about it a lot, yeah? We like to define it how it is when it is a mud, you know, how it is when it is like this, how it is, you know, what can I do, you know, once I, yeah. And that is the real problem, yeah? Why do we get distracted? Once we don't get distracted, we start to see. As long as we still get distracted, we can't see. We can't really see what is going on. And because it is so difficult not to get distracted, then we start to think. Yeah, we think about the Dhamma. We think about We think about the kilesas. We think about greed and hate. Yeah. But that doesn't help us. We have to. And that is where we have to put our effort in. Yeah? Why are we constantly being distracted? Yeah? What is it that pulls us out? Yeah? And why are we still falling for it? Yeah? I mean, how often have you thought this thought? And you can't still get enough of it. How often have you had this memory and you still can't get enough of it? Huh? How often have you had the worries or the fears and you still want more of it? That should be the interesting question. Yeah? Why is it so easy for the kilesas to pull us out? Yeah? They just throw in something into our brain, you know, a smoke bomb, you know, it's called, yeah, this memory or that thought, yeah. And then we get confused, yeah. We look, where is it coming from? Where is it coming from? Yeah. I don't want it, you know. Instead of putting our attention back, back where it belongs to the tip of the nose or back to the Buddha, not being interested in all these smoke bombs. So the question is not why we are distracted, yeah, because of the smoke bomb we don't see for a moment, yeah. It is how we are going to deal with this distraction. Yeah? Do we go out and find the reasons why it has appeared? Or do we go instantly back the moment we notice the smoke bomb has appeared, yeah? Instantly go back to the Buddha. Yeah? Not being interested what is happening. Yeah? There's a nice story, I don't know if it is true, but yeah, I mean it sounds true. Yeah. There was a meditator, or was it a monk, you know, sitting in a kuti, yeah, meditating for hours, and then the thought arises, it's getting hot. Yeah. So he went back to his meditation object, and then a thought arises, it's getting hotter. Yeah. Going back to meditation, and suddenly, you know, I mean, there was some smoke as well. And then he opened his eyes and his kuti was on fire. Yeah? And then he ran out. He got distracted for a while, yeah, until it becomes really, really dangerous. Yeah? So we should not ask ourselves why we get distracted. We should instantly return back to the Buddha or back to the breath. Yeah? And that's how we can quieten down the mind. Yeah? And the moment we quiet down the mind, yeah, all the smoke of the thoughts and the memories disappear and we start to see clearly. Yeah? And whatever we want to see, whatever we want to know, is that when we can know it, yeah? When the mind is clear. But it has to be clear not only for 1 second, it has to be clear for a while. Yeah? And then we start to see, and then we start to understand. And then if you have a problem with one of the suttas, if our knowingness is really clear and sharp, I mean we can understand what it meant. That's how we see it. Yeah? We just bring it up and then suddenly we do understand. Yeah? Maybe not the first time, but the second or third time. But we are trained, the problem is we are trained in our life to try to understand with our brains. Yeah? And that's not going to lead anywhere. That only goes to lead to new definitions. Yeah? The can is opened, I'm filled. Yeah? We define the Dhamma the way we like it. Or the way we view it. We don't really, even when we read it or when we hear it, we really do not understand what is said. Yeah? Because the Dhamma is just pointers to the path that shows us, points to signs that we will find along the path. Yeah? And if we don't walk the path, we will not see them. And only once we see them, we will understand the meaning of it. I mean, I can tell you a lot about the practice, about the experience one can have in the practice, but this is my experience, It's not your experience. But if you go the path that leads to this experience, you will have a similar experience. And then you will understand what I was talking about. Even if I use some words that were inappropriate. So the language are only pointers. I tried to explain that quite a few times. The language is only pointers to a value that is stored somewhere. If you don't go and to see the location where the value is stored, then we will never know what it is. We don't know what is in there. So the Lord Buddha taught us the path and said, along when you walk the path, you will see this and you will see that. You will experience this and you will experience that. And that's why we have to walk the path. And one of the most difficulties for us is, to concentrate on one point. Yeah, to do the first step of the path. Why is it so difficult? I mean, we've done nothing else, in our life than thinking and memorizing and forming views and opinions. Yeah? We read something and then we form an opinion about it. Yeah? And this opinion seems then to be the truth for us. Yeah? What is written there, we really don't know. Yeah? They are just words, Each word does have a value, it points to something. Yeah? But if you don't know the experience, then we don't know what it's talking about. Yeah? Everybody seems to know the words, yeah? I mean, just a simple word, yeah? What is pain? Every one of us knows, yeah, pain, yeah? The word, yeah? And he's really afraid of pain. Yeah? But what is it? How does it feel like? How does it work? How does it appear? How does it disappear? We don't know. Something within us tells us there is pain, and instantly then we try to remedy it. Yeah? We need to go to see the doctor. Yeah? Or we need to take some pills. Or we need to do this or to do that to get rid of pain. But we don't even know what is pain. And in our investigation, we can investigate pain. And if we start to investigate pain, maybe then we come to the understanding, seeing the pain within the pain, seeing the feeling within the feeling. Yeah. But if we don't do it, we will never come to the understanding what the Lord Buddha means when he says it. But these are all things that are unpleasant. Yeah? Don't think it is easier with a pleasant feeling. Yeah? Yeah? Try to pinpoint a pleasant feeling. Huh? Can you do that? It's even more difficult than an unpleasant feeling. Yeah? Because our mind is instantly aloof, yeah? It's riding on high clouds. Oh, that's a nice feeling, you know, how can I get more of it? How can I continue it? No? What did I do to get it? Yeah? That's the first thought. What did I do to get it? Yeah? So we are off the feeling, we don't even know how it feels like. And that's why I say, you know, the words are just pointers to the truth, yeah? And we use the pointers as reality. Now, do you see the dilemma we are in? Yeah? We use the words, we use our language, talk about things that we really don't know about. Yeah? If we would investigate pain, then we would understand what is pain and we don't have to run away from it. And then we would be able to compare pain with feelings of fear or anxiety or worries or pleasant feelings. What's the difference between the feeling of a pleasant feeling and the feeling of an unpleasant feeling? We don't know, do we? We only think these are pleasant feelings, we only think these are unpleasant feelings. But we don't know how they feel. What is the experience when I say we don't know how it feels? What is the experience of it? What is your personal experience? Not the experience of others, what is your personal experience? How does it feel? Pain. How does it feel being in joy? How does it feel having metta? Yeah? How does it feel having equanimity? Yeah? These are things, yeah? We talk about it all the time, huh? But we don't know what we're talking about. Isn't that strange? Huh? And then we even argue about it. No, it's not like this. No, it's not like that. Huh? So the path that leads to the end of dukkha starts with sila, yeah, and then comes to samadhi, and then only then comes to investigation. Yeah. And what do we investigate first is the body. And together with the body comes bodily feeling. So, even in samadhi, you know, we are constantly bothered by these pains, yeah? The pain that arises in the back, the pain that arises in our knees, yeah? or in our shoulders, or whatever. Yeah? So we could then investigate what is pain. Yeah? Why do I have to move? Yeah? When the body sleeps, yeah? Or when the citta dreams, where's the pain? Why is there no pain? Yeah? Mm-hmm. Try to lie for 3 hours? Awake? Huh? Can you do that? Huh? Constantly need to move, yeah? When the citta is asleep, it doesn't need to move. So where is then the pain? Yeah? when somebody sits in deep samadhi for 7 days, you know, not moving anything, oh, that must be in constant pain. Does the body know what pain is? No? Ask it. Does the tendons know what is pain is? No? Does the flesh know what pain is? Ask anything. Yeah? You get an answer? There's an uncomfortable feeling. There's a comfortable feeling. That's what we can say after a while. And we know, and we will see, through our investigation, comfortable feelings arise and cease. Uncomfortable feelings arise and cease. They come due to their own nature. And if we don't observe them, we will never understand their nature. I mean, what do people do? Yeah. I mean, they observe pigs, they observe birds, they observe, you know, lifelong, yeah? In order to understand, you know, what is their behavior, yeah? They observe plants, yeah? Try this out, try that out. I mean, most of our science is based on these old observations, yeah? Nowadays we don't observe anymore, we just... just build hypotheses, yeah, about how things are working. But in the beginning of science, I mean, people were observing, yeah, and learning a lot, yeah. I mean, how is the gravitational law coming into place, yeah? Newton sitting under a tree, you know, seeing an apple fall down from the tree, yeah. Isn't that observation? Yeah? Through the observation, he got an understanding. Yeah? And through our observation of pain, we will get an understanding. Yeah? Through observation of any kind of feeling, we will get an understanding what this feeling is. But we have the problem the moment when I say, I'm in pain. Yeah? Or my stomach hurts. Yeah? Yeah. That's a problem. End of the problem. End of the investigation. Yeah? Then the only thing I know how to do, yeah, if this condition arises, yeah, then we go and have this kind of medicine or that kind of medicine. Yeah? Or go and see the doctor. Yeah? Have a look at it. Yeah? We are not ready to observe because we don't even actually want to know. Yeah? But the Buddha's path is the path to observe. And when we sit in samadhi and pain comes up, then we investigate the pain. What is pain? Yeah? First of all, we say there is pain, and then really breathe it in. Feel the brain. Feel the pain, yeah? Completely, 100%. Is there some adversary reaction? Then we can't see it. We really have to welcome it. There's pain, okay, thank you. Now I have a steady object. It's not as flimsy as our Buddha or not as flimsy as our breath. It is more stable and it is more... predominant than anything else. So how does the pain feel? And this, I'm mostly talking about pain, but this holds true for any kind of feeling. Feelings that are more, even more difficult, are feelings of fear. But we can investigate them the same way. Once we can accept them, once we can feel them, once we see them, how they arise and cease, then we can also see what brought them into coming. So we will understand the nature. Just like, you know, in the beginning of science, through observation the understanding comes. Yeah? If they didn't observe correctly, everybody saw the apples falling down from the trees. Yeah? But they didn't observe it. Yeah? How it falls. Yeah? And they didn't wonder about it. Yeah? Just like most of us don't wonder about it, yeah, how these feelings come into contact. If you want to understand the universe, we have to be, in a certain sense, we have to be one of these old scientists who observe. Yeah? What came before the feeling of fear? Was it a thought? Was it a sensation? Yeah? Was it a sense contact? But before the sense contact, what came before? Yeah? What came after the sense contact? Was it a memory? Yeah? Was it a thought? What came? Yeah? That is observation. But if we can't accept the feeling of pain, or if we can't accept these uncomfortable feelings, then we cannot investigate it. And then we cannot understand the nature of pain, and we cannot understand the nature of fear, the nature of loneliness, and so on. How we investigate pain is how we can investigate any kind of feeling. The first thing is, it's not me, it's not mine, it's not myself, it doesn't belong to me. The second thing is to accept it. Breathe it in fully, completely, without any reaction towards it, or against it. And stick your attention to the Buddha or to the breath, while you do it. Yeah? And then you ask, then you observe it, until it disappears. If you stick to your Buddha, if you don't let your mind out, go into another thoughts and another memories, then it will cease very quickly. But if there's a reaction towards it, even the slightest reaction, I don't like it, that keeps it alive. These things we have to understand, but we have to observe. Through observation we will see. Through seeing we will understand. That's the teaching of the Lord Buddha. Open your eyes and see for yourself. But we love to sleep, the dream world is much nicer, because in the dream world we can change reality, That's why we stay in the dream world, We don't like reality, So we change it, by dreaming something else. Huh? But once in a while you come out of this dream world and it's a disaster, Nothing of this dream world, fits into the reality, And that's where we get a shock, that's where we feel dukkha. Yeah? And if we can't build another dream world, where we can hide, then we have some dukkha. And then we might come to this place, to to understand, People from the West don't like these unpleasant things that appear in meditation. Yeah? They do meditation, they do it wholeheartedly, and put a lot of effort in to get rid of unpleasant feelings. Yeah? To get into a nice state, They should take drugs in Ireland. It's not the point, you know, to get rid of it. It's the point of practice is to understand what is happening. I mean, that was one question that was driving me on my way of practice. Yeah? What the hell is happening? Yeah? What's going on now? Yeah? Why does somebody tell me I have to do this? Yeah? Actually, I don't want to do it. Yeah? Then I started not to doing it. Yeah? And things like that. Yeah? What is happening right now? I mean, that's where we are in the present moment. And then we see. Things arise and things cease. Yeah? Thoughts come and thoughts disappear. Memories come and memories disappear. Feelings come and feelings disappear. And they have nothing to do with us. Yeah? It's just like we sit on a TV that is on for 24 hours. Yeah, and our whole field of view is only this TV. I mean, it's constantly on. Yeah? Constantly something is happening. Yeah. And in the end, we believe we are the things that are on this TV. Yeah? Huh? You remember the times when you sit in the movie? Yeah? And you're suddenly completely lost in that movie? Yeah? How easy it is? Yeah? When we close our eyes, the inner movie comes up, yeah? And we get lost into that. We always believe it, you know, we get angry about it, you know, we laugh about it. We feel sorry for ourselves or we feel sorry for others. I think it is one of the best examples, because people don't notice when they're sitting in the cinema and watching a movie that they are getting lost in this movie. But probably that's why they look at that. All this entertainment, and now we don't even have to go to the cinema for it anymore. We just take out our phones, you know, smartphones, you know, and watch it. Nowadays we can live so easily in a dream world. We don't even need to know reality. Yeah, we just connect to our phone. You know, I mean. The next generation of smartphones you put in front of your eyes, and yeah, they are so smart, you know, they tell you if you run against the hindrance. Yeah? You don't have to take your eyes off the smartphone anymore. Yeah? And then we are completely deceived. Then we really don't know what is going on in this world. But that's how easily we get fooled. Yeah? The moment we close our eyes, I mean, there's the world of senses, you know, that constantly contact us. Yeah? The sense of hearing, the sense of smelling, the sense of touching. Yeah, feeling cold is the sense of touching, or feeling hot is the sense of touching. Yeah, or thoughts. Yeah? Thoughts that come in, yeah, the sense of thoughts. Yeah? Constantly we are bombarded by these senses. Yeah. Then you should close your inner eyes and just concentrate on the Buddha or on the breath. It's a mental repetition of the word Buddha, 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 Buddha. Yeah? I mean, Buddha is actually the nominative of Buddha. Yeah, I mean, in... Probably in Vietnamese you don't have declination. But in Pali you have it, yeah? I mean, Buddha is the nominative and Buddha is the accusative. Yeah? I mean, we have cases, yeah? I mean, I think in English we call it cases. Yeah? What is it?
Discourse.
Yeah. It's a case, yeah? You have... But you have genitive, you have dative and accusative. In Pali you have six cases. Yeah? So I mean, and then it changes the end of the end of the nominative changes. Yeah. Or it's called substantive. I'm not so. It's long ago. You probably had it as well. French is full of these things. So Buddha and Buddha is the same thing, yeah. So you repeat it mentally, yeah. And Buddha brings you the same way to the heart, yeah, as breathing in, yeah, being concentrated on the breath at the tip of the nose, yeah. Yeah. The citta, the heart, and the mind are actually, you know, pretty much the same thing, yeah. When I talk about the heart, it's the emotional aspects of the citta. When I talk about the mind, it is the rational aspects of the citta. Yeah. When I talk about the kilesas, it's also an aspect of the citta. Yeah? They're all there. Yeah. The one who knows is the true citta. Yeah. I mean, you can see the citta as a diamond. Yeah. Yeah, is the essence of the citta, yeah. The one who knows is the citta, yeah. But you will get to this only if you get rid of everything else, yeah. So if you really dive deep into apana samadhi, when everything disappears, when the whole world disappears, then you really get to know the true essence of the citta, yeah. I mean, when you look at a diamond, yeah, you don't see the nature of the diamond. You see all the facets, and they're all reflecting something else. Yeah. So the emotional part is one of the facets. Yeah. The rational part is one of the facets of the diamond. You call everything the diamond. You call it the citta. Yeah. But when normally we talk about the citta with all these aspects. Yeah. And aspects is greed, anger, hate, delusion, and so on. They are all aspects of the citta. But the nature of the citta is annoyance. And it's only one nature. Yeah. Yes. It can last for just a minute. It can last for 4 days. Yeah.
So when is enough to come to Thailand?
If you can stay concentrated on one object without distraction for 10 to 15 minutes. But before that, you can do something else that doesn't require that kind of concentration. You can reflect about death. You can reflect about birth. You can reflect about illness. Yeah. You can reflect about old age. Yeah. Just looking at the examples. Yeah. Looking at your parents. Looking at your grandparents. Yeah. Looking at babies. Yeah. Then you see the whole aspect of human life. That is reflection that leads to wisdom, yeah? That can lead to wisdom, but you don't need that good concentration. Yeah? Reflecting about what you do, yeah? You can do with little samadhi. Yeah? You don't get as much, yeah? Of course, you will understand much better the clearer the samadhi is, yeah? The clearer your concentration is, yeah? But these things you can do. But in order to investigate the body properly, yeah, you really need to be able to stay, yeah, because for instance, when we investigate nails or hair of the head, yeah, then we have to repeat hair, 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 hair until we see the hair with our inner eyes, yeah. The same is with an inner organ, or the same is with the skin, yeah. The outer things are much easier because we can look at the skin for 5 minutes and then close our eyes and still have the image of the skin. Yeah? But you can't, you know, I mean, if you don't open your body. So that is the first training. That's why a monk is given only the outer aspects of the body. So the hair of the body. I mean, when we shave, you know, tomorrow we probably, the day after tomorrow we shave, yeah? So we can see the hair, yeah? In our hands, so we can contemplate it, yeah? The moment, as long as it is on your head, you know, you think it's fine, yeah? When it goes and falls into your food, you don't like it anymore. Why? Yeah? Or when it goes down, you know, when you wash your hair, you know, and it goes into the drainage together with soap, you don't like to pick it up. But as long, you know, I mean, you constantly touch it, yeah? But then when it is down there, when it is off the body, everything that is off the body we find disgusting. Huh? When you clip your nails, you know, you find it disgusting. The dirt under it, yeah.
So while it's eye, it's okay, right?
Yeah, so while you think it is on the body, you know, it's okay. But the moment it falls off the body, I mean, just take some of the skin, you know, that falls off the body, yeah? I mean, when you have a wound, you know, and then it heals, you know, and it falls off, yeah? People normally find it disgusting, yeah? So why is it? Yeah? That's a question you should ask yourself. The food, you know, that goes in, you find lovely, yeah? Especially in the morning, yeah? When you have to throw it up because, you know, I'm in some stomach problems, yeah? You don't like it anymore. The question is, why is it like this, yeah? Nobody has taught you that. Yeah? When you fart, yeah, the smell that comes out of the body, sometimes it's really disgusting. Yeah? Whatever comes out of the body, we find disgusting. Whatever goes in or on the body, we find beautiful. I mean, there's some sort of contradiction. And this contradiction we have to solve, yeah? And the things that we find disgusting, yeah, brings up anger, and brings up, first of all, it brings up irritation, and then it brings up anger. Yeah? And then we can learn how to deal. Before we learned how to deal with pain, now we can learn how to deal with anger, yeah? Or with greed. Yeah? Things that we like, yeah, the food, yeah, we like, you know, so greed comes up. Yeah, if we see something. Certain drinks, yeah? Greed comes up. We like something, yeah?
Greed, you mean anger? Oh, sorry, greed, you mean craving?
Like, yeah.
Desire?
Yeah, desire. Yeah. Yeah. You're British and you don't understand greed?
Well, I think greed is a really strong one.
Oh, it's strong, yeah, just like anger, it's strong, or hatred is strong, yeah? No, I mean, it's just liking, yeah? I mean, you can... The forms that we don't notice as greed and hate are liking and disliking. Yeah. Just like dukkha, you know. Dukkha is not only suffering, you know, it is a lot of discomfort, you know. It's already starting with irritation, it starts with, you know, discomfort, yeah. Dis-ease, not feeling comfortable, yeah. In, you know, up to pain and suffering, yeah. So is it with greed. It starts with liking something, until you can't let go, until you have to have it, yeah? That's what you normally call greed, yeah? But everything is, you know, it is just a container for everything that you like, you know, like you want to have, yeah? And everything that you don't like to have is hate, yeah? So it's more container for all these things, yeah? We've put so many, the more words we generate, the more confused we get. We don't know what is what, yeah? We think they are different things. Liking is okay, but, you know, being greedy is not okay, yeah? With liking and disliking, all the problem starts already, yeah? So, now I went off the track. I don't know where did I get off? Somebody listen to it? Michelle listens normally very well, so where did I get off the track? I was investigating the body, you know, that brings up irritation, yeah? So a form of anger, form of hate, and it brings up also greed, yeah? But the things that we want for our body, huh? Or that we want to put on, we like, yeah? And the things we dislike. So greed and hate is very, very much connected with the body. If there's no body, I mean, we would have such a fantastic life. Wouldn't need to worry about all these things, yeah? You didn't need to work, you know, to get some food, yeah? I mean, that is all of your life, yeah? You work, you know, to feed the body. To house the body, to shelter the body, and to find some medicine, yeah? Nobody... This type of reflection, I mean, you can do without a lot of samadhi. Yeah? Just think about, yeah? Being born, you know, training yourself, yeah, to become proficient, you know, in walking, you know, in talking and in thinking, yeah? This doesn't require a lot of awareness, yeah? Well, that's a good reflection, yeah? Reflecting about death, what is happening, you know, when we die, yeah? What is death like? Have we seen people die? Yeah? And then watching them. Yeah? And then seeing ourselves die. Yeah? Or putting ourselves in the situation. Tomorrow you go to the doctor and he says, you have three more weeks to live. Yeah, last stage of cancer. What do you do? Huh? Put yourself in the situation. Yeah, feel it. I mean, of course we know what we do. Buddha, 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 Buddha. Huh? Or anapanasati. Yeah? So that we are clear in the moment of death. Yeah. But people get completely frantic. Yeah? If they go to the doctor and see the doctor and say, you know, I mean, you have three more months to live. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Last stage of cancer. I mean, it upsets the whole world. Yeah. We know we are born and we know we are dying. Yeah. Yeah? Why does it upset us, you know, when we know we have to die? We know it from the moment of birth, yeah? Huh? Nobody tells us when we have to die, but we know we have to die, yeah? So if somebody tells us we have to die in 3 months, you know, we suddenly get upset. Why?
Maybe we don't believe that we will ever die.
Yeah.
There's still a doubt.
Yeah, of course. That is something, you know, that's why I say sometimes, you know, we do have the notion that we are immortal. Yeah. There is something that is immortal, yeah? The citta, yeah? That never dies, yeah? But everything around the citta dies, yeah?
Sometimes you can be happy, but you can feel the pain.
Yeah, I mean, the pain of death is as much, you know, I mean, as the pain of birth, yeah? It's a little bit worse, yeah? I mean, the pain of birth, you know, for both the mother and the child.
But if you came through a cesarean, through operation, you would know the pain of birth.
No.
Is there a pain...
No, but if it comes through, what is it, through the uterus? Yeah, then you know the pain of birth. Yeah? Probably it's the easiest birth for both the mother and the child, yeah? Opening up, yeah, the stomach. Yeah, I mean, we are afraid of pain. We are not really afraid of death, yeah? We are only afraid of death if we know we are going to hell. Yeah. The chitta knows what it has done, you know. It knows if it has to go to hell or not, yeah. And we all have done bad things, yeah. So hell is always an option for us, yeah. None of us, you know, has stayed doing his life within the five precepts, yeah. We all have broken the five precepts. We all know that what it means, yeah. And we are only afraid of hell because we know hell. We have been there. That's why we are afraid. Yeah? if your parents would have told you, you know, there's a realm that is called Kamura, yeah? It is very terrible. So what? But if they talk about hell, we instantly understand what they mean.
Yeah, how do we know what is hell?
Because we have been there so often. Yeah?
Yeah.
That's why we know it. And that's why we are afraid of it. Yeah?
We can be quite quiet when we don't know exactly about 5%, because sometimes we think that we didn't do so much bad things to go to hell.
But then somebody comes up and tells you. as long as the people around us, you know, that's what we do, human beings, yeah? We see what other people are doing, you know, what they get away with, yeah? So we start to do the same thing, yeah? They are out of bounds, and then we become out of bounds. And because everybody around is out of bounds, we don't think everything, you know, anything will happen to us, yeah? But then somebody comes, you know, tells us, the masses are going through the broad door that leads to destruction, only few go the stony path that leads to the heaven, yeah? I mean, but that was long, long time ago. That's 2,000 years ago, yeah? Even longer was 2,500 years, where the Buddha taught us, you know, you see the bull over there, you know, how many horns does he have, how many hairs does he have on his fur, yeah? And then for 2,000 years we don't hear anything, yeah? I mean, the Christian church is talking about hell, yeah? If you don't give to the church, you go to hell, yeah? Things like that. Yeah, it's interesting, yeah? I mean, we are not scared of anything, you know, that we don't know. That's why we are really up to the task to explore any realm, you know? I mean, we like to go there because we don't know it. We don't even know the dangers that are lurking there, and we just go, yeah? Going into the jungle of Amazon and things like that, yeah? I mean, there are quite a few beasts, you know, and poisonous plants and things like that, yeah? People can die, but they are not afraid of it, yeah? But once they know the dangers, yeah, they might not go back, yeah? And we know hell and we know heaven, yeah? That's why we like to go there, yeah? But all these things are just intermediate, yeah, realms of existence. Yeah? The chitta, yeah, is the everlasting tourist that goes from one realm to the next. Yeah? Doesn't worry about it. It cannot be destructed. Right? You cannot destruct anything. You cannot annihilate anything that has never been created. You can only annihilate things that have been created. Yeah? So this body has been created. It can die. Yeah? Feelings. Yeah? I mean, what are we? What are we? Yeah? I mean, we are Rupa, Vedana, Sanya, Sankara, Vinyana. So we are body. Yeah, that's what we think we are. We are the body, we are the feelings, we are the memories and association, we are the thoughts, and we are consciousness. Yeah? Consciousness is very fast. It dies so fast that we can't even catch it. Yeah? feelings, they die, yeah? They are born and die, and we don't worry about it, yeah? Pretty quickly. Thoughts, even quicker, yeah? Memories take a little bit longer, yeah? But during one day, you know, how often do we die? If you think, you know, it's my feeling, you know, I mean, the moment this feeling is gone, we died. Huh? If I think this is that thought, it's my thought, the moment this thought disappears, you died. Or not. And when a new thought comes, you are born again. Yeah? And that thought, you know, is gone, you know, you die again. It's these five khandhas that we associate with, you know, that we relate to. Yeah. The body is the thing that lasts the longest, yeah? That's why we are so afraid, yeah? I mean, the thoughts, you know, we are not afraid, you know, we know, well, they come again, yeah? I mean, when we are Buddhists, you know, we do know we get another body, maybe not this one, but another body, yeah? So, I mean, it's really, if you take a few steps backward and see, you know, the lives that we have lived, yeah? And so we don't worry about that. Yeah? What we worry most is the pain, yeah? The pain of death, yeah? The pain when the body breaks apart. That's why, what we can do in meditation, you know, and see. Hey, hey. Huh? Yeah, I mean, that is even worse in hell. Because we can fall unconscious of pain. In hell we can't die. That is why it's so terrible. There's no way to escape, yeah? Until, you know, until our karma of this lasts, you know, I mean, we will be pained and pained and pained and pained. And we don't fall unconscious, yeah, and we don't die because of the pain. As human beings, you know, if the pain is too big, we die. It's a good relief, yeah? But in hell, we don't die. We will be released from prison. Moving a little bit. We will be released from prison after a while. The good thing about hell is not everlasting, yeah? The bad thing about heaven, it's not everlasting. So the important thing is to get your act together. Stick with the point. Yeah? Stick with the point of concentration. I mean, if you do anapanasati, you can do, yeah, observing the breath going in, going out. And it is too difficult. You can do put with breathing in, eye, with breathing in, and do with breathing out. Yeah? Still concentrate around the tip of the nose. Yeah. But keep it. Keep it. Don't go out. And then, if you go out, ask yourself, how often have I had this thought? Does it bring me any happiness? Does it bring me any pleasure? Yeah? This memory, how often did I have it? Yeah? Is it the first time? It's a new memory? Yeah? It's old. Yeah? So we say it's old coffee, yeah? Cold, old coffee, yeah? When it is fresh and hot, you know, then it tastes nice, yeah? Huh? But is there something new that came up? Huh? It's only always a reiteration of something that we've known for ages. Yeah? Is it something new that constantly comes up in your meditation? Not sure. Because you have never thought about it.
Actually, when I'm listening, I can see that.
say since the beginning of the practice, they didn't let that mind, their mind, get outward. I don't know how they could do it. But they did. Not of good timing and not of effort, but also good timing because you only have time.
What Ajahn Suchard said that?
Yeah, Ajahn Suchard and Ajahn Martin.
Mm-hmm.
The beginning of the practice.
The mind never went out.
They didn't allow.
They didn't allow the mind to go.
No, that didn't happen because they had to struggle also.
Yeah. Everybody had to struggle. I mean, even Lungta Mahaboy, his mind was going out constantly. And Lumpuman, his mind was going out constantly. But everyone has to struggle, yeah? And that's what we have to do, yeah? I mean, I had to struggle 1.5 years, you know, I mean, it was terrible, yeah? But I didn't allow it, yeah? I wanted, yeah, I mean, this is something, you know, I really wanted, yeah. I wanted that the mind is stable at this one point. Yeah. That's what I really wanted. Yeah. And sometimes I tell, you know, the stories in the beginning, there's so many thoughts, you know, I mean, I just took a machine gun, you know, and killed them all off, yeah. Hmm? What's the use of it, yeah? I mean, I just said, these are my enemies, kill them off, yeah? But there were some thoughts, you know, with bulletproof vests, you know, that came through. There were the more difficult ones. They had, you know, they told me they had a reason, you know, to come in, yeah? And in the beginning, I believed them until I know I was fooled, yeah? And then I started, you know, to be more rigorous. And then I started to be even more rigorous, yeah? None of them are allowed. Yeah? If I do samadhi, everything that comes in that is not the Buddha or is not the attention on the breath, yeah, is not allowed in. Yeah?
If you take too much attention in it, yeah? And after all is hurting, you know, and you can't dress anymore and you are in a very bad position.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you go on.
But you cannot bring your
yeah.
Time,
yeah.
Yeah.
Are you dying?
When you try to keep it
constantly? Yes. Yeah.
Day.
Yes. I mean, what did Lungta talk about? It was hell. Yeah. The first three days when he didn't allow his mind to go off. He was in hell for 3 days. I mean, that's the same thing, yeah. This question will come up, you know, it will come up the latest, you know, when you try to go into Apana Samadhi, yeah? What is going to die? Whatever can die, let it die. Yeah? Whatever can live, you know, stay with it. So when the heart, when it clutches so much, you know, then stay, you know, just stay with the Buddha, you know, and see whatever can die. I mean,
yes,
it feels tight, yeah? The only thing that you have to check that you do not tighten it, yeah? Mm-hmm. That you, not self, you know, try, you know, to force it too much, yeah?
What you have to do at that time?
Only bring it back.
Too much, or if it's, you have to...
You don't have to force it at all. You just bring it back. Yeah? That's where you have to put the force. Yeah. But if you try to force it too much here onto the heart or onto the nose, that's not good. Yeah. I mean, that makes it. Yeah. But I doubt that it is like that. Yeah? Then just see what is happening in this moment. Yeah. The Kilesa is telling you die. Yeah. And you say, okay, let's go and die and see what is left. Yeah? I always was interested. Yeah. See, I mean, that is where the spirit of the warrior comes in. He wants to know what is happening. Yeah? Because we know the chitta cannot die. But everything that is not the chitta can die. Yeah? So let it die and see what is happening.
I don't think it's okay that I had fear, but that I thought that I was doing something wrong, not in the right way, to have that kind of result.
No, it can happen.
It's normal?
It can happen. I don't say it's normal. It can happen. Yeah. The only thing that you have to check out in this moment, you know, if you put too much force on it. Yeah. If the force is not to let the mind out, that is proper. Yeah. If you too much force concentration on a certain area, that's not proper. Yeah. But if you use the force, you know, not to let the mind out, that is proper. If you use too much force on the body or on a certain area of the body, that's not proper.
Yes,
that's how you can distinguish between these two. Yeah.
I got it better after following Ajahn Damadero and your email advice.
Hmm?
I think it was better after having followed the advice of Ajahn Damadero and also your email. So email and had also advice.
Mm.
After it has been better.
What's in there? Chili?
Aloe vera.
Aloe vera. Mm. Okay, so now we are pretty much up the question. Yeah? Vietnam, where's your questions? No? You know what you have to do, huh? Yeah? And you can do this easy reflection. Yeah? I mean, what happened during the day, you know, about, you know, birth, you know, to old age and death, yeah? Or, you know, whatever comes out of the body, you know, why do you find it disgusting, yeah? This reflection you can do any time, yeah?
But how to keep the concentration in our daily life?
What? Keep the concentration what?
In our daily life.
Yeah.
Is it easy to keep concentration here?
Yeah, yes, of course it is, yeah? That's why you should, you know, when you're back in your life, you know, you should at least in the morning before you do anything. Do an hour of meditation or 45 minutes of meditation and then do your thing. You know, when you come back home, the first thing is, yeah, do meditation before you start doing something at your home, yeah? And maybe then you can do the reflection afterwards, yeah? You cannot keep the same kind of concentration as you. That's impossible. Yeah? But it is much easier at home. If you just do it 2 hours a day at home, I mean, because you're really tired, you know? I mean, you don't want all this sense input, you know? So you're much easier to concentrate on the Buddha or on the breath, yeah? But when you do it here for 12 hours a day, it's so difficult.
The saturation. After you don't know where you are. You're completely...
Yeah.
You don't know where is the Buddha, where is the breath, where is it? It's very strange.
Mm. No, it feels like, yeah. But that's where we can go to deeper levels, yeah.
I was reflecting this morning what happened at that stage, when, you know, how to go deeper when you just stayed.
You know, the easy way is how to go deeper is putting one step in front of you. Yeah? Yeah? That is how you go deeper. Yeah? If you constantly, yeah? If you constantly think about, yeah, how can I get deeper? Yeah? The question is, one more Buddha gets you deeper.
It's what I did. Then I will arrive somewhere.
Okay? You okay? I didn't ask you today. Yeah? Just go on. Yeah? Just like in life, there are nice times and there are more difficult times, yeah? In life we have no problem, you know? We still go on, yeah? But when meditation, everything should be fine, you know? That's when we don't go on, yeah?